This lesson is taken from my course, Blockchain in Supply Chain Management. Enjoy.
In this lesson, we're going to be talking about basic blockchain cryptography concepts. To begin, I'd like to begin with a definition of what cryptography is. Cryptography refers to the study and application of techniques used to transmit, protect, and store information and communications in a secure and private way in order to avoid being intercepted by third parties, that is, an adversary. Now, some key terms that I want to tell you about are the first one, encryption. Encryption is also known as encipher or encode, and it's the process of converting information into unintelligible code to protect it. Now, if you encrypt something, you can decrypt it. So we talk decryption. Decryption, also known as decipher or decode, is a process of converting encrypted information back into unencrypted form. Every time you are dealing with a website and you use your password, what's really happening is that you are using cryptography. Let me explain how this applies in the context of blockchain, but by first giving you a basic example of encryption and decryption. So, if I give you this specific example, this is actually a communication. But right now it is encrypted. You can't understand what it says because I have actually encrypted it. I'll now go through the process of decrypting it so you see how it works. To do this, I'm going to use what's known as a Caesar cipher. Now, a Caesar cipher is a type of substitution cipher in which each letter in plain text is replaced by a letter of some fixed number of positions down the alphabet. What do I mean by that? If you look at this Caesar cipher, what you find is that the letters on the outside, that is the uppercase, are labeled as plain text, and the lowercase ones on the inside are ciphertext. What that means is that the ciphertext will be the encrypted version, and the plain text version will be the decrypted version. Just as some background, Caesar ciphers have been around since as far back as Julius Caesar, who used it in his private correspondence, and it was extremely well used for a very long time. Let me use in this specific example how we're going to use it for this example that I presented to you. If we turn the wheel, and we turn it specifically 19 to the counterclockwise, you will replace the letter A, which is the plain text, with a lowercase t. The B would become U, etc. This is what's known as a key of 19. That is, we are moving the Caesar cipher 19 places counterclockwise so we can replace the letter A with a letter T, the lowercase t. And now we've got our decryption mechanism. So let's apply that to the example we showed before. So if we follow that specific example, what we find is that it translates into this. I have a secret. This example is what is known as shared secret cryptography, also known as symmetric cryptography. Why? Because both the sender and the recipient of the message, that is the encryptor and the decryptor, they use the same exact key. You need to know that the key is 19 in order to encrypt it and to decrypt it. This has vulnerabilities. I'll give you one example. Let's assume that Alice wants to send the message to Ben and she wants to encrypt it. Well, Ben doesn't know the key yet. Somehow, Alice has to get that key over to Ben. Well, let's bring in an adversary, in this case, Eve. And let's assume that while Alice is sending that key over to Ben so he knows how to decrypt it, Eve manages to get a hold of it. If that happens, then we have a big problem because Eve can basically decrypt the messages and she could even replace it with her own. This is a huge vulnerability. And when you hear about sometimes websites getting hacked and millions of passwords lost, often it's that it's shared secret passwords. And if somebody knows all the passwords and you can hack that source, you can basically steal all the passwords. Why? Because it's a shared secret. That's why shared secret cryptography does have some major vulnerabilities. Now, let's go into a different example. In this case, I want to go into what's known as public key cryptography. And this is what's used extensively in blockchain. Now, in that scenario, let's assume that Alice wants to send the same message to Ben. We also have the same adversary, Eve. Now, for Alice to send that message to Ben, in that case, has two keys, a public key and a private key. This is the public key cryptography component, because the public key, Ben can share it with anybody. The purpose of the public key is merely to encrypt information. Right now, Alice can take that message and encrypt it using Ben's public key. Now, Alice can then send the encrypted message over to Ben, and the only person that can read this is Ben, because he has the private key for it. Furthermore, let's assume that Eve were able to get a hold of that public key. It doesn't do anything for her. So the point is, stealing a public key will not do her any good. That's why it's perfectly okay for Ben to share his public key with anybody, because all it really does is encrypt messages. Let me tell you a little bit more about public key cryptography. Public key cryptography, also known as asymmetric cryptography, is a cryptographic system that uses two keys: a public key, which allows anyone to encrypt a message and you can share it with everyone, and a private or secret key known only to the recipient of the message. Now, this public key cryptography uses two keys, as I mentioned, a public key and a private key. The private key is kept secret by one individual. The public key can be shared with anybody. This is an alternative to shared secret or symmetric cryptography. It's extensively used in blockchain. Furthermore, it's used to generate digital signatures to validate the authenticity of data. That is, only the person that has the private key can sign a document or a file, and you can tell that that person is authentic, because only that one person would be able to actually have the private key for that. Under that scenario, the public key would serve as a way of verifying that the person that actually signed that document is the authentic, genuine owner of that private key. Now, we've spoken about encryption and decryption, we've spoken about public key cryptography, and we've spoken about digital signatures, which is the process to validate the integrity and authenticity of data. Now, I will tell you about another important concept, which is a cryptographic hash function, and this is critical in the concept of blockchain. A cryptographic hash function takes an input, that is a message, of any length, and returns a fixed size alphanumeric string called a hash value. This hash value serves as a digital fingerprint of the message. Let me give you an example of how that works. For instance, if I write hello with an uppercase H, it will give me this. That is a cryptographic hash using what's known as SHA-256. SHA stands for Secure Hash Algorithm, and SHA-256 is a type of cryptographic hash algorithm. There are others, but in this case, I'm showing you SHA-256, which, by the way, is the same cryptographic hash that's used in Bitcoin. Now, if I take hello and I add two exclamation points after that, the cryptographic hash changes completely. Furthermore, I can put a much longer message. For instance, in this case, Mary had a little lamb whose fleece was white as snow, and you also can get a cryptographic hash for that. In all cases, it's a fixed size alphanumeric string. That is, it doesn't matter how long the string that you turn and you insert and convert into a cryptographic hash, you will always get a fixed size alphanumeric string.
I hope you enjoyed this video and that you learned something in the process. I bring you brand new videos every single week, so I invite you also to subscribe so we can stay in touch. Also, if you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them below. I would love to hear from you. Until next time, we are changing the world, one blockchain at a time. I'm George Levy. Thank you for watching.